I'm on top of the world, hey. I'm on top of the world, hey. Waiting on this for a while now. Paying my dues to the dirt. I've been waiting to smile, hey. Been holding it in for a while, hey. Take you with me if I can. Been dreaming of this since a child. Good day! Our topic for today in Principles of Volcanology and Seismology is the history of seismology. Seismology, as many of you may already know, is a specific branch of geology that is the study of earthquakes. The first part of my presentation is to describe the ancient portrayal of earthquakes. Early historical records contain references to earthquakes as far back as 2000 BCE. There is a natural tendency to exaggeration in describing such phenomena, sometimes indeed to the extent of importing a supernatural element into the description. For example, ancient Egyptians believed that the earthquakes are caused by the laughter of their god of the earth, Geb. In Greco-Roman mythology, Poseidon, or Neptune, the god of the sea, is also known as the earth shaker. It is known to have a bad temper. When he became angry, he would hit the ground with his trident, which causes earthquakes. In the Norse mythology of Scandinavia, the god of mischief, Loki, is tied to a rock in an underground cave as punishment for murdering his brother, Baldur. Above his face is a serpent dripping poison, which his wife, Sigyn, catches in a bowl. From time to time, she has to go away to empty the bowl. Then, the poison falls on Loki's face, causing him to scream and writhe from the pain, shaking the earth around him. In Japanese mythology, the Namazu, or Onamazu, is a giant underground catfish living under the islands of Japan and is guarded by the god Takemikazuchi enshrined at Kashima, who restrains the catfish with a stone. When the god lets his guard fall, Namazu thrashes about, causing violent earthquakes and tsunamis. Hindu mythology from India claims that a weak vulture carries a snake, which in turn carries a tortoise, and this tortoise balances 8 elephants on its back that hold the earth. When any of this creature gets tired and moves, the earth shakes violently. The second part of my presentation concerns a more scientific approach to explaining earthquakes. Attempts were made by some ancient writers on natural philosophy to offer rational explanations of earthquake phenomena. These views indicate very clearly that the early Greek philosophers had already abandoned the mythological explanations in favor of natural causes of earthquakes inside the earth. One such philosopher is Thales of Miletus. His theory about the cause of earthquakes is consistent with his hypothesis that the flat earth is actually floating on a vast ocean. The earth is said to quake when it's fluctuating because of the roughness of oceans and disturbances in that, causing the earth to shake or even crack, just as they would a large boat. Democritus claims that the earth is full of water and that when a quantity of rainwater is added, an earthquake is the result. The hollows in the earth being unable to admit the excess of water, it forces its way in and so causes an earthquake. Or again, the earth, as it dries, draws the water from the fuller to the emptier parts, and the inrush of the water as it changes its place causes the earthquake. Anaximenes claims that the earth breaks up when it grows wet or dry, and earthquakes are due to the fall of these masses as they break away. Hence, earthquakes take place in times of drought and again of heavy rain, since the earth grows dry in time of drought and breaks up, whereas the rain makes it sudden and destroys its cohesion. The famous philosopher Aristotle says, "We must suppose the action of the wind in the earth to be analogous to the tremors and throbbing caused in us by the force of the wind contained in our bodies." Thus, some earthquakes are a sort of tremor or throbbing. Again, we must think of an earthquake as something like the tremor that often runs through the body after passing water, as the wind returns inwards from without in one volume. In a nutshell, when a very large amount of wind gets built up inside the earth, it must burst forth. When it does, it causes earthquakes. Basically, Aristotle thinks that the earth farts. Unsurprisingly, the previous Greek philosophers discussed gave descriptions that are too fanciful and outlandish. However, it was a Chinese scientist that offered a more rational explanation for earthquakes through experimentation. Zhang Heng, or Xiang Heng, is a polymathic scientist, mathematician, astronomer, and geographer during the Han Dynasty of China. He invented the earliest instrument made to respond to earthquake ground motion, called the seismoscope. The seismoscope was cylindrical in shape, with 8 dragon's heads arranged around its upper circumference and aligned to the cardinal directions, each with a ball in its mouth. Directly below the dragons were 8 frogs. When an earthquake occurred, a ball dropped and was caught by a frog, generating a sound and supposedly showing the direction of the earthquake.
Hi everyone, I am Kenneth James, and I am going to report about modern scientific discovery of earthquakes. So, drastic changes in scientific thought took place during the 16th and 17th centuries, a series of events that marked the emergence of modern science during the early modern period, when developments in mathematics, physics, astronomy, and chemistry transformed the views of society about nature. This series of events is called the Scientific Revolution. So in this presentation, we are going to delve into the timeline of modern scientific discoveries, which made contributions to the study of earthquakes. So in 1660, Robert Hooke discovered his law of elasticity, which states that the stretching of a solid body is proportional to the force applied to it. The law laid the basis for studies of stress and strain, and for understanding of elastic materials. In 1855, Luigi Palmieri built a seismograph in the observatory on Vesuvius. It consisted of an inverted pendulum hinged below by a cylindrical steel wire. A pencil attached to the top of the pendulum rod recorded the motion on paper. In 1889, Ernst von Ruber Paschwitz was experimenting in Potsdam with a modified form of Zollner's horizontal pendulum when an earthquake from Japan was recorded. This event marks the birth of instrumental seismology in its worldwide sense. In 1897, Richard Dixon Oldham, a British geologist and seismologist who discovered evidence for the existence of the Earth's core. His study of the Assam earthquake in 1897 revealed 3 separate kinds of earthquake waves on seismographic records and established that these waves travel along different paths and at different speeds through the Earth. In 1906, Harry Fielding Reid studied the geodetic measurements along the San Andreas Fault before and after its rupture and consequently expounded his elastic rebound theory, which draw attention to the significance of elastic strain energy in connection with earthquakes. In 1909, Andrija Mohorovicic discovered a sharp material discontinuity at some level below the Earth's surface, known today as the MOHO, which could explain the travel times of seismic rays from a local earthquake. It was subsequently found to demarcate the base of the Earth's crust. This discovery demonstrated that the structure of the Earth's outer layers could be deduced from travel times of reflected and refracted seismic signals. Alfred Wegener, in 1912, is a German meteorologist and geophysicist who formulated the first complete statement of the continental drift hypothesis. And in 1914, Benno Gutenberg studied records of earthquakes that had epicentral distances of over 80 degrees from Göttingen. He had found that at a depth of 2,900 kilometers, the velocity of longitudinal waves decreased from 1325 to 18.5 kilometers per second, and that the radius of the core is about 3,500 kilometers. A value little different from modern determination. In 1930, Harry Hess was an American geologist and a United States Navy officer in World War II who is considered one of the founding fathers of the unifying theory of plate tectonics. He is best known for his theories on seafloor spreading, specifically work on relationships between island arcs, seafloor gravity anomalies, and serpentinized peridotite, suggesting that the convection of the Earth's mantle was driving the driving force behind this process. In 1935, Charles Richter introduced an instrumental earthquake magnitude scale. This was based on an earlier attempt by Wadati in Japan. In 1936, Angie Lehmann postulated the existence of an inner core to account for the amplitudes of P waves between angular distances of 105 degrees and 142 degrees, previously thought to be diffracted waves. In 1960, the realization that ocean floors behave differently to continents led to the theory of plate tectonics. And in 1961, a worldwide earthquake monitoring system was set up. Several systems now exist, including the Global Seismographic Network. They contribute to the understanding of plate tectonics and other earth processes. In 1995, the first slow slip events noticed in Japan and Canada. These are helping to explain the plate movement and stress buildup in subduction zones. And in 2002, another slow slip event was recorded in New Zealand. So the next topic would be about the important scientists and discoverers of seismology. Clarence Edward Dutton, American geologist and pioneer seismologist who developed and named the principle of isostasy, advanced a method for determining the depth of the focal point of an earthquake and for measuring the velocity of waves with unprecedented accuracy. Benno Guttenberg, American seismologist noted for his analysis of earthquake waves and the information they furnish about the physical properties of the Earth's interior. John Michell, British geologist and astronomer who is considered one of the fathers of seismology. He presented the conclusions from his study of the disastrous Lisbon earthquake of 1755. Harry Fielding Reid, an American seismologist and geologist who in 1911 developed the elastic rebound theory of earthquake mechanics, which is still accepted today. Charles Francis Richter, American physicist and seismologist who developed the Richter scale for measuring earthquake magnitude. John Milne, English geologist and influential seismologist who developed the modern seismograph and promoted the establishment of seismological stations worldwide. Richard Dixon Oldham, British geologist and seismologist who discovered evidence for the existence of the Earth's core. And lastly, Hugo Benioff designed and constructed an instrument to measure a component of ground strain. So the next topic would be about seismology. Now, what exactly is seismology? So by definition, seismology is the study of earthquakes and seismic waves that move through and around the Earth. These waves are caused by the sudden movement of materials within the Earth, such as a slip along a fault during an earthquake. Volcanic eruptions, explosions, landslides, avalanches, and even rushing rivers can also cause seismic waves. These waves travel through and around the Earth and can be recorded with seismometers. So the two main types of waves are body waves and surface waves. Body waves can travel through the Earth's inner layers, but surface waves can only move along the surface of the planet, like ripples on water. Earthquakes send out seismic energy as both body and surface waves. So there are two types of body waves, the P waves and the S waves. So the P waves, or the primary waves, has the higher speed of propagation and so reaches a seismic recording station faster than the secondary wave. And the S waves, also called shear or transverse waves, cause points of solid media to move back and forth perpendicular to the direction of propagation. As the wave passes, the medium is sheared first in one direction and then in another. So there are two types of surface waves, the Lob waves and the Rayleigh waves. So Lob waves are propagated when the solid medium near the surface has varying vertical elastic properties. displacement of the medium by the wave is entirely perpendicular to the direction of the propagation and has no vertical or longitudinal components. So, Rayleigh waves. Rayleigh waves travel along the free surface of an elastic solid, such as the Earth. Their motion is a combination of longitudinal compression and the dilation that results in an elliptical motion of points on the surface. Of all seismic waves, Rayleigh waves spread out most in time, producing a long wave duration on seismographs. So, the triangulation is a method that uses distance information determined from three seismic stations to uniquely locate the earthquake. On a map, circles are drawn around each seismic station. The radius of the circle are scaled to the estimated distance from the station to the earthquake. So as you can see here on the picture, the seismometers are shown as green dots. The calculated distance from each seismometer to the earthquake is shown as a circle. The location where all the circles intersect is the location of the earthquake. Thank you so much for listening. That will be the end of my presentation. Have a good one.